بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وجعلنا من أعوانه وأنصاره. I am grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving me this opportunity to be with you and share with you our joy for the great occasion of Eid al-Ghadir. And I hope that inshallah what I'm going to say would be beneficial for all of us. And I hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us for the respect that we show to this occasion of Ghadir, more love and more understanding of wilaya of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Alhamdulillah alladhi ja'alana min al-mutamassikin bi wilayat Ali ibn Abi Talib wal a'immat al-ma'sumin alayhim as-salam. So in order to have a better understanding of wilaya, I thought of talking tonight about wilaya, and what does wilaya mean? This is a concept that has been discussed by different scholars from different schools of Islam, Sunni, Shia. They all have discussed about wilaya. But it seems that still this concept is not sufficiently known. Not only we have not been able to know awliyaullah, even we have not been able to understand the concept of wilaya, let alone to know the wali. Everyone knows verses in which term wali is mentioned. For example, in the verse 55 of Surah Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إنما وليكم الله ورسوله والذين آمنوا الذين يقيمون الصلاة ويؤتون الزكاة وهم راكعون. Everyone knows this. Even it seems that there is no doubt among all Muslims that the one who gave charity, who gave his ring as infaq when he was in ruku, is Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam. But then there is a diversity of opinion about what does it mean innama waliyukumullah. So some people say means your friends, your beloved is Allah, is Rasulullah, and then all mu'mineen, because it says alladhina amanu, doesn't say in a singular way, it's plural. So a very significant ayah which has been revealed to identify who is wali is unfortunately respectfully left aside by saying wali means something else. So the ayah is not used as a proof. Why? Because it really means something else. They don't say we don't accept ayah, but they say it means something else. And there are many cases like this. Or when Rasulullah said, "Man kuntu mawla, fahada aliyun mawla." They say mawla means friend. If you have taken me as your friend, now you should take Ali as your friend. So the term wali and the root wilaya is something which has not been well received. Unfortunately, even we followers of wilaya, we Shia also have not completely grasped the meaning of wilaya. So we are one step ahead, but still we haven't reached the point. So what I am trying to do is to reflect on the notion of wilaya and see what is wilaya, and then how can we strengthen our wilaya. I have been thinking for some years, and then I came to this conclusion, and I'm going to share with you. I have also mentioned this in some of my works. If you are interested, you can follow it up. Wilaya seems to be a type of relation. So it's a relation between two or more people. It can be a relation between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu waliyul ladina amanu. So for mu'mineen, Allah is their wali. And it is interesting that this relation is mutual. So Allah is wali for mu'mineen, and also mu'mineen are wali for Allah. Inna awliya Allah la khawfun alayhim wa la hum yahzanun. So Allah is wali for mu'mineen, and mu'mineen are awliya for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we are talking about a type of relation that also is mutual. It's not just from top to bottom or from bottom to top. It can be both. Also, it's a relation that is between us and those leaders that are appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So not only Allah is our wali, also Rasulullah is our wali. Innama waliyukumullah wa rasuluhu. Ahlul Bayt are our awliya. But in the same way, we are also their awliya. They are our mawla, we are also their mawali. So the relation is again mutual. And also it can be horizontal. Al-mu'minun wal-mu'minat ba'duhum awliya'u ba'd. All the believers are wali for each other. You are my wali, I am your wali. Every mu'min is wali for another mu'min. Now, the question is, what does this relation involve? Is it just love? Is it just friendship? Or it's more? We should know that similar relation, with some differences that inshallah I will explain, also exists between kuffar and their masters. And I mean by kuffar not atheists, I mean by kuffar those who are against faith. Because there are faithless people who are not against faith. Kafir, Allama Tabatabai says in Al-Mizan volume 1 that many times in the Quran means kufr al-juhud. Because we have four types of kufr. Normally when we say kafir means someone who is deliberately, knowingly rejecting the truth and standing
as a barrier between the truth and people. This is the meaning of kafir. Some people think kafir means everyone who has no Islam is kafir. No. This is a particular sense. So kuffar also have their own wilayah. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَوْلِيَاءُهُمُ الطَّاغُوتُ. So if Allah is wali for mu'mineen, in the other side also you have friends or followers of shaitan whose wali is taghut. And also among themselves, shayateen also are awliya for each other. So wilaya is not necessarily showing that there is sacredness, there is holiness. No, it depends whose wilaya you have. Do you have wilaya of Allah and Rasulullah and Ahlul Bayt, or you have wilaya of shaitan and satanic people? So wilaya is like imama. Imama by itself doesn't mean it's good or bad. We have a'immatan yad'una ila an-nar. Yeah? And we have a'immatan yahduna bi'amrna. So wilaya is a type of relation that exists between two groups of people with their masters. What we have in the party of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the camp of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is first. So I'm talking about different elements in wilaya. First, ma'rifah. Can you have wilaya without ma'rifah? It's impossible. You say, I have wilaya of someone, but I don't know him. This doesn't work. Wilaya without knowing is like loving without knowing who is your beloved. Let's say a young boy said to his parents, I need to get married. They said, why? He said, because I have fallen in love. Now you have to help me. They said, okay, we go and propose marriage. Who is the one that you have fallen in love? He said, any girl. They said, this doesn't make sense. If it's love, love belongs to a beloved. You cannot say, I love someone, but I don't know who is that person. This doesn't work. You cannot say, I have wilaya, but I don't know who is my wali. Who are my awliya? I don't know them. It doesn't work. Ma'rifa is the first step for coming into the relation of wilaya. This is why Sunni Shia, they all have narrated that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man mata walam ya'rif imam az-zamanihi mata mitat al-jahiliyyah." If someone dies without knowing imam of his age, he dies the death of ignorance. It's like the people who died before knowing Islam. Actually, it's worse, because those who died before Islam came, they have some excuse. But if you die at the age of Islam, but like Jahiliyyah, then you don't have excuse. Yes? Because when Allah gives you a blessing and you don't appreciate, you end up with being in a worse situation. وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ وَلَا يَزِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَارًا. So those who existed before revelation of Quran and they didn't have iman, they are much better than people who had no iman after revelation. So, if someone dies without having ma'rifa of imam of his age, mata mitatan jahiliyyah. And indeed, as I said, his situation even is worse. So ma'rifah is very important. Ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How much we can know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? There is no limit. If we day and night try to improve our ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, still we can learn more. Still there is much more to discover. When Rasulullah says, "Ma arafnaka haqqa ma'rifatik," we have not known you in the way that you deserve, then we know that we have not had even a little of ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So a mu'min who wants to have a strong wilaya should spend time, energy, make efforts to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more and better. Ma'rifah of Rasulullah, ma'rifah of imams, ma'rifah of imam of our time is needed. How can we know them? One part of it's coming to majalis, listening to lectures, madrasa, but this is not enough. You have to have plans for a study, serious study, systematic study, not just scattered ideas, bits and pieces. You have to have a holistic understanding of Islam. You have to have a strong aqeedah. This is very important. And when it comes to Imam Zaman, your ma'rifah cannot be what is written in the books of aqa'id. This is a very important point. What does it mean to know Imam of your age? What type of ma'rifah of Imam of your age saves you from jahiliyyah? Just knowing the name of Imam al-Zaman and name of his father and mother, the date of birth, the day he went to occultation, is saving me from jahiliyyah? Just having this data is going to give me right direction in life? Is this guaranteeing that I am serving my Imam and listening to my Imam in day-to-day affairs? No, this is not enough. Knowing the leader of your age means you know what he wants from you in this age. And that has to be translated to a plan. What I am doing for my Imam? What are the challenges for my Imam and his community? And what are the ways that I can help? Who are working for Imam? Who are working against Imam? I should know all of them. So ma'rifat Imam Zaman is ma'rifah of Imam and ma'rifah of Zaman and ma'rifah of the will of Imam in this Zaman and the helpers of Imam in this Zaman and the enemies of Imam in this Zaman, the opportunities for Imam and his community in this Zaman, the threats, all comes under ma'rifah of Imam Zaman. Otherwise, how am I going to follow Imam? What is the difference between me and a person who lived 1,000 years ago? We have the same information about Imam al-Zaman. If you look at the books on Imam al-Zaman written by Sheikh Tusi and Sheikh Saduq and Sheikh Mufid and Nu'mani, you find that they had more information than we have today about Imam al-Zaman. But that is not enough. That is theoretical information. That is general information. I need that type of ma'rifah of Imam al-Zaman that can affect my life, that can put me in right direction. So ma'rifah is very important. And ma'rifah of the community. In Ziyarat Ashura we say, As'alullah alladhi akramani bima'rifatikum wa ma'rifati awliya'ikum. Who are awliya for Ahlul Bayt? These are the Shia. These are the followers. We have to know Imam and we have to know the followers of Imam. Your wilaya is not complete unless you know all the people who are working for Imam, all the people who are connected to Imam. What is happening to them? There is a beautiful hadith from Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. About the rights of mu'mineen over each other. The huquq, the rights that mu'mineen have over each other. When Imam Sadiq alayhi salam mentions these rights, then at the end he says, فَإِذَا فَعَلْتَ ذَلِكَ. If you make sure that you observe all these rights, وَصَلْتَ وِلَايَتَكَ بِوِلَايَتِهِ. If you observe the rights of mu'mineen, then your wilaya will be connected to their wilaya. Means, as a drop of water, you will merge with other drops of water and become part of the ocean of wilaya. Wilaya is not one drop with imam, another drop with imam, another, no. Wilaya is an ocean. If you want to become part of that ocean, you have to merge with other mu'mineen and form the community, real community. A community that has full understanding of each other, full sympathy for each other, love for each other, they die for each other. This is the community. Every day, we are supposed to start our day with Du'a-i Ahd. What is the significance of Du'a-i Ahd? Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, several generations, before Imam Mahdi was born, several generations before Imam Mahdi was born, asked the Shia to recite this dua in the time of Ghaibah of Imam Zaman. And in this beautiful dua, when you want to send salutation to Imam, how do you send salutation to Imam? اللهم بلغ مولانا الإمام الهادي المهدي القائم بأمرك صلوات الله عليه. عن جميع المؤمنين والمؤمنات. Oh Allah, send salutations and salawat to Imam, not on my behalf or behalf of my parents. No, before my turn comes, talk about mu'mineen and jami'il mu'mineen wal mu'minat. All mu'mineen, men and women, fi masharigh al ard wa magharibha, in the east and west. And actually it says Masharq, east and west, because earth is moving and east and west are changed. Sahlaha wa jabalaha, barraha wa bahraha. It means that early morning after Salatul Fajr, you remember Imam and you have to remember every single mu'min in the world. Before you remember yourself and your parents. And this cannot happen just by reciting Du'a-i Ahd. This has to be put in our education. This has to be put in our syllabus, in madrasa, in a school, in member, Muharram, Ramadan, so that we would have, inshallah, a generation of mu'mineen that before they think about themselves and their parents, they think about every single mu'min in the world. If we reach that point, then we would have no conflict. You would have no division. You would not have any problem in families, in communities, and so on and so forth. Then we can hope that we can be helping Imam Zaman. This is a condition for a person who is muntazir. And then such people can hope to be helper of Imam Zaman. If we don't have this condition, even we are not muntazir, let alone to be a helper. So, ma'rifah is very important. ma'rifah of Allah, ma'rifah of Rasulullah, ma'rifah of Imam, ma'rifah of the time, the people. I don't have time, so I leave it for the time being and I move on to the second element. The second element of wilayah is obedience. Obedience is very important. You cannot have wilayah without organization. If there are people that everyone is free to do what he wants and doesn't feel responsible to take commands and instructions from the authority and be answerable, there is no wilayah. People who do whatever they like, whatever they enjoy, they cannot claim that they are part of wilayah. What did Rasulullah say on the day of Ghadir? أَلَسْتُ أَوْلَىٰ بِكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. Don't I have authority over you more than what you have over yourself? If Rasulullah tells us something, we cannot say, let me think. Let me ask my solicitor what my solicitor says. Let me ask my wife, my children, my husband. Let me ask, I don't know, my elders. If Rasulullah says something, if Imam says something, if Quran says something, if our marja, our leader who represents Imam says something, we don't need to even think twice. We have to do it. Otherwise, there is no wilaya. Wilaya is coming with obedience. أَتِيُوا اللَّهَ وَأَتِيُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. So who are أُولِي الْأَمْرِ? We have to obey them. Some people have very broad understanding of Ulul Amr. Many of our Sunni brothers, they say, everyone who has power is Ulul Amr. Everyone who has established himself as a king, as a ruler, as a leader, he's Ulul Amr. We don't have that understanding. But anyone who is a legitimate leader, anyone whose authority is coming from Quran and Sunnah, that's Ulul Amr. We cannot say, we do whatever we want. For I do if I am convinced. فَلَا رَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتْ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. Allah says, by your Lord, they are not mu'min unless if they have problem, if they have dispute, they make you the judge, and whatever you judge, they accept without feeling any unease. لَا يَجَدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتُ. It's not just they accept. They don't feel any negativity. This is the amount of submission that we should have. If Rasulullah says something, it's not just enough that I listen. I should be fully convinced and I should be happy. If I am mu'min, if I am not mu'min, that's another issue. So, obedience is very important. Even obedience is not always from people who are lower to the people who are higher in rank. Even we should have obedience with respect to the mu'mineen who might be in our own rank. Al-mu'minuna wal-mu'minat. Look at this beautiful ayah. Al-mu'minuna wal-mu'minat ba'aduhum awliya'u ba'd. All the believers are wali for each other. One implication of this is ya'muruna bil ma'ruf wa yanhauna 'anil munkar. They do amr bil ma'ruf. How can I do amr bil ma'ruf? I can do amr bil ma'ruf if you listen to me. If I have right of asking you, but also you have right of amr bil ma'ruf. So if you tell me something right, I have to listen to you and obey you. Maybe today I learn from you, tomorrow you learn from me. But we have to obey someone who speaks the truth. If someone speaks the truth, he has authority. This is a beautiful point in Islam. Some people think the authority necessarily comes from the one who speaks. So I say, who are you that are telling me? So if you can convince him that you have a position that he has to respect or obey, he listens. Otherwise, he doesn't listen. But in Islam, we say in addition to some people holding a position that you have to respect and obey, the truth by itself has authority, no matter from whose mouth it comes out. When truth comes out, even if it's from a child, you have to listen. This is the authority of truth. Why? Because ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهُ هُوَ الْحَقِّ. Allah is al-haq. Allah is the true and the truth. And anything truthful is a manifestation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So sometimes I say, if there is a dispute between husband and wife, and the other party is telling the truth and we don't accept, we are not just fighting that person, we are indeed fighting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because it's not important who is telling the truth. Truth is a manifestation of absolute truth, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you don't accept the true word of your wife or husband, you are showing enmity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So obedience is needed. In the opposite camp, they have also ma'rifah. They know their leadership very well. They know the people who are working for them very well. They are very also organized. They have obedience even more, maybe. Look at the people of Sham, how much obedience they had for Muawiyah. Much more than most of the people of Kufa. If Muawiyah was telling them to do something, they were not questioning him. They were not challenging him. They were not bringing excuses. Even if he was asking them to do Jum'ah on Wednesday, he had no problem. Everyone was in the mosque. But our people, even on Jum'ah, they don't come. Muawiyah was asking them to come to Jum'ah, everyone was there. Our people don't come for Jum'ah. Why? Because they have more obedience. They have more discipline. They have more organization. They plan very nicely everything. So, in both camps, there is ma'rifah, there is obedience, there is organization, but there is a third element in the camp of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the wilayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is not in the other camp. What is that third element? After ma'rifah, after ta'ah, after knowledge and obedience, what is that third element? Mahabbah, love. In the camp of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everyone loves his or her fellow awliya. You love Allah, Allah loves you. You love Rasulullah, Rasulullah loves you. You love Imam, Imam loves you. You love fellow mu'min, brothers and sisters, they love you. Everyone cares for others. Everyone loves others. Why? Because Iman requires loving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم والذي نفسي بيده لن تدخل الجنة حتى تؤمنوا. By the one who has my life in his hand, you don't enter heaven unless you are faithful. ولن تؤمنوا حتى تحابوا. And you are not mu'min unless you love each other. So, we say usuluddin are five. Tawheed, nubuwwah, ma'ad, imam and ad. It's correct. But there is also something which is missing. And that is to love for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is very important. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked his companions, "Ayyuhar al-iman awthaq?" Which handhold of iman is the strongest, is the firmest? What is urwatul wuthqa for iman? The firmest handhold. Some said Salat. Rasulullah said Salat is important, but not the firmest. Some said Zakat, no. Siyam, no. Whatever they mentioned, no. Rasulullah then himself said, Al-Hubb fi Allah wal-Bughd fi Allah. If you love for the sake of Allah and dislike for the sake of Allah, that is the firmest hand. Such a person would never fail. If your love for people and for things is coming from your love for Allah, you don't have any problem. It's like a person has given control to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah has taken your control, then you don't go to the right direction. Because our control is based on our love and hatred. This is the way we move, the way we act. So, in the camp of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is love in dunya and akhirah. Even in akhirah, they don't forget each other. Mu'mineen would not forget each other. Mu'mineen that meet each other in masjid, in other good places, they work together for Imam Zaman. Inshallah, in akhirah also, they do shafa'ah for each other. They will not forget each other. Ulama do shafa'ah, mu'mineen do shafa'ah, Ahlul Bayt do shafa'ah. They don't forget each other. Even sometimes a father do shafa'ah for his family, a mother can do shafa'ah. There is a hadith that a person on the Day of Judgment will be judged and Allah says, you can go to heaven. But his family cannot join him. They haven't done that much of good things that can be with him. Maybe not heaven, maybe not in the same rank. Then he says, look at this. This is mentality of mu'min. A mu'min would not just want to save himself. A mu'min wants to save everyone. So he says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, عَمِلْتُ لِي وَلَّهُمْ. Oh Allah, whatever I did was for myself and for my family. Then Allah says, let them join him without dividing what he has done into the number of the family. And this is Quran. أَلْحَقْنَا بِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَمَا أَلَتْنَاهُمْ مِنْ عَمَلِهِمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. We let their progeny join them without reducing from their reward. This is mu'mineen. The love of mu'mineen, dunya and akhirah for each other is there. What about the other party? When you look at them, you think they love each other. When you look at them, you think they are very united. But no. There is no unity. It's just discipline. Everyone works as they want him to do, but they don't love their masters. تَحْسَبُهُمْ جَمِيعًا. When you look at them, you think they are very united. وَقُلُوبُهُمْ شَتَّى. But their hearts are divided. Right now, for dunya, for money, for power, for position, they work together. But they don't love each other. Like two partners in business, that only because of money they are together. The day they realize they can be better off if they work separately, they separate. There is no love, there is no unity, there is no concern. It's just for some practical reasons that they are together. Like modern understanding of family. Unfortunately, in the modern understanding of family, you live with someone just for practical reasons. Because you don't want to be alone at home. You want someone with whom you can share your bills, and so on and so forth. There's no love, there's no unity. And as soon as the husband or wife realize they can be better off if they are separate, they say, I don't want to see you. This is, unfortunately, the way family has become in liberal societies. And this is the way that, unfortunately, we are also getting into it if we are not careful. So, for practical reasons, they work together, but they don't love each other. On the day of judgment, this becomes manifest. On the day of judgment, they will not be resurrected as friends, they will be resurrected as enemies. Why? Because they were enemies. الْأَخِلَّاءُ يَوْمَئِذٍ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٌّ إِلَّا الْمُتَّقِينَ. All the friends become enemies except muttaqeen. Muttaqeen remain friends. Apart from muttaqeen, they become enemies because they were enemies. But it was covered. It was covered. So, there are three elements in wilaya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The wilaya in which there is nur, there is light, there is guidance, there is truth, there is justice. Ma'rifah, ta'ah, mahabbah. In the opposite camp, there is ma'rifah, there is ta'ah, no mahabbah. No mahabbah for the people who are inside the camp, and definitely no mahabbah for the people who are outside. Now you understand ayah 56 of Surah Ma'idah. 55 was إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ رَاكِعُونَ. What is 56? مَنْ يَتَوَلَّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فَإِنَّ حِزْبَ اللَّهِ هُمُ الْغَالِبُونَ. So now you understand that wilaya is to form hizb, to form a party, organized group. I'm not saying hizb in the sense of political parties, it's much more than that. You have to organize yourself. So wilaya and tawalli is very clearly defined in the Quran if we understand it. So we have Hizbullah, we have Hizbulha, we have Hizb of Light, means organized camp. And we have Hizbul Shaitan, Hizbul Batil. How many groups of people we have? Do we have only two Hizbs? Or we have more Hizbs? It seems that we have only two Hizbs, but three groups of people. How it comes? How we can have only two camps but three groups of people? We have people who have organized themselves in Hizb of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have people who have organized themselves in Hizb of Batil. And we have people who are not organized, who have not adopted any aims and objectives for their life. They are not under any leadership. Quran says, Muzabzabin. They are people who are sometimes moving towards east, towards west, no clear direction, no principle. They just do what suits them. They can be very educated, they can be very rich, but they haven't yet realized to whom they should associate themselves. And these are not enemies. You have to know that. Don't think if someone is not seen in the camp, they are enemies. No, these are the people who are not enemies. If you are careful, you can bring them to your camp. If you are not careful and forget them and only make yourself busy with your internal affairs, they will be hijacked by the other camp. So whoever is more clever tries to invest on attracting these people. And this is why it's very important for us to reach out. If you don't reach out, you will lose. You will just increase your enemies. Because the other camp is not just, you know, idle or, you know, just, you know, sitting and relaxing. They are working day and night with everything to take those people to their side and make them against you. if you are not careful. We should do the opposite. We should reach out and work with them. So we have two camps, but three groups of people. Who is in the camp of Haqq? This is something that you cannot decide by names. You say, okay, my name is Ali Hussein Fatima Zahra, so I'm in this camp. No. No one can decide this by names. No one even can decide this by who is praying, who is fasting, who is going for Hajj. No. In the time of Rasulullah, you couldn't understand Mu'minin just by appearance. We had many munafiqeen inside Medina. On the day of Ghadir, you couldn't see who really believes and who doesn't believe because everyone paid allegiance. In Ashura, you were not able to see who is right, who is wrong based on Salat and Zakat. No. It's not something that you can decide by name, by Salat, by Zakat, by Ziyarah, by crying. No. This is something that everyone has to carefully examine. Is my life dedicated to promoting the cause of Haqq and justice or not? If I die or I continue to live, is it going to have any impact on the conflict between Haqq and Batil or no? If I am useless in this battle and conflict, so I don't belong to that camp. If I'm not in the opposite camp, I'm just in the middle. But if my energy, my skills, my time, my money, my children, my reputation, all are serving Haqq, all are serving the people who are working for promoting Haqq, then inshallah I am in the right camp. Maybe there are non-Muslims who are working for Imam Zaman. Maybe there are Muslims who are not working for Imam Zaman. If Imam wants to establish justice, so he would have helpers maybe from outside Islam, those who are working for justice. But if it is a Muslim or even a Shia who doesn't bother at all about justice, then how can he say, I'm helping Imam? If you have a medical doctor, for example, who is working hard, struggling to cure ill people, who is helping him? Anyone who is helping him with treatment is helping him, whether he's a Muslim or not, whether he's called this name or that name. Of course, I'm not saying they are equal, but I'm saying that your main direction in life is important. This is the life which is not the life of Jahiliyyah. If you are moving in the same line and direction that your Imam is moving, then inshallah you are with Imam. If you are not careful, other people will come and replace you. And they will have the honor of helping Imam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to hasten the reappearance of Imam Zaman Ajjalallahu ala farajahu al-Sharif. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase our ma'rifah and our ta'ah and our love for Imam Zaman and mu'mineen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to be that generation who would pave the way for coming of Imam Zaman. May Allah make all our progeny at the service of truth and justice. May Allah give shifa to all the brothers and sisters who are ill. May Allah send His unlimited rahmah to all mu'mineen who have passed away, the martyrs, the teachers, the ulama, the maraji, our parents, and also the marhumin, the mu'mineen who passed away in Mina, in Hajj this year. May Allah send His rahmah to all of them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our community a community which is pleasing Imam Zaman. May Allah make our families, families which please Imam Zaman. May Allah make our centers and institutions, centers and institutions which please Imam Zaman. And may Allah make the last moment of our life the best moment of our life. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. More love and more understanding of wilaya of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Alhamdulillah alladhi ja'alna min al-mutamassakeen bi wilayati Ali ibn Abi Talib wal a'immat al-ma'sumin alayhim as-salam. So in order to have a better understanding of wilaya, I thought of talking tonight about wilaya, Mom, and what does wilaya mean? This is a concept that has been discussed by different scholars from different schools of Islam, Sunni, Shia, they all have discussed about wilaya. But it seems that still this concept is not sufficiently known. Not only we have not been able to know awliyaullah, even we have not been able to understand the concept of wilaya, let alone to know the wali. So a very significant ayah which has been revealed to identify who is wali is unfortunately respectfully left aside by saying wali means something else. So the ayah is not used as a proof. Why? Because wali means something else. They don't say we don't accept ayah, but they say it means something else. And there are many cases like this. Or when Rasulullah said, man kuntu mawla fahadha aliyun mawla, they say mawla means friend. If you have taken me as your friend, now you should take Ali as your friend. So the term wali and the root wilaya is something which has not been well received. Unfortunately, even we followers of wilaya, we Shia also have not completely grasped the meaning of wilaya. So we are one step ahead, but everyone knows verses in which term wali is mentioned. For example, in the verse 55 of Surah Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Innama waliyukumullahu wa rasuluhu wal-ladhina amanu al-ladhina yuqimuna as-salata wa yu'tuna as-zakata wa hum raki'un. Everyone knows this. Even it seems that there is no doubt among all Muslims that the one who gave charity, who gave his ring as infaq when he was in ruku, is Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam. But then there is a diversity of opinion about what does it mean innama waliyukumullah. So some people say it means your friends, your beloved is Allah, is Rasulullah, and then all mu'mineen. Because it says Alladina Amanu doesn't say in a singular way, it's plural.
الله الرحمن الرحيم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وجعلنا من أعوانه وأنصاره. I am grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving me this opportunity to be with you and share with you our joy for the great occasion of Eid al-Ghadir. And I hope that inshallah what I'm going to say would be beneficial for all of us. And I hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us for the respect that we show to this occasion of
still we haven't reached the point.
So what I am trying to do is to reflect on the notion of wilaya and see what is wilaya and then how can we strengthen our wilaya. I have been thinking for some years and then I came to this conclusion and I'm going to share with you. I have also mentioned this in some of my works. If you are interested, you can follow it up. Wilaya seems to be a type of relation. So it's a relation between two or more people. It can be a relation between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu waliyul ladina amanu. So for mu'mineen, Allah is their wali. And it is interesting that this relation is mutual. So Allah is wali for mu'mineen, and also mu'mineen are wali for Allah. Inna awliya Allah la khawfun alayhim wa lahum yahzanun. So Allah is wali for mu'mineen.